No, any professional plumber looking at this is gonna shoot himself in the head. But the big epiphany I had after years of running it was, yeah, I got more valves and circulator pumps than I can shake a stick at, and I haven't paid a dime for heating my house or my shop in the last 40 years.
All right, guys, Tom is gonna show us his hydronic heating system. Basically, this whole concrete floor has radiant tubes in it, the PEX tubing. This system, when did you have this built?
I built this 18 years ago, and I had one real similar I built about 40 years ago.
Yeah.
So it's proven everything works.
And this is somewhat of an older system. You were kind of a pioneer in some ways.
Yeah, but I just don't want people telling me it won't work because it has worked.
Yeah.
It's worked for decades.
Yeah. Now, this system is heated multiple ways. You got the boiler here.
Yeah.
And then
here's the biggie.
Yeah. Let's go show that.
These are hydronic solar water heaters, just copper tubing, all factory built back in the day. Absorber plates, you run water through them, it heats it up. It's pretty simple.
How many gallons is this?
These six, I did the math once, and they put out the BTUs roughly equivalent to about 2.5 gallons of propane wood. Day after day, year after year, those panels are about 30 years old. And they've handled all kinds of the stormy weather we've had up here. Then there's three more in the house in back.
And those heat your home?
Well, yeah. Everything's kind of...
Is it a separate system?
Well, it's ice bike.
No. You have those panels heating just the shop?
They're connected.
They're connected?
Yeah. In a way. So...
There's a heat transfer somewhere.
Those heat the floor directly via this heat exchanger.
Okay.
The glycol fluid, actually, it's a closed-loop glycol loop. Comes down, goes through this plate heat exchanger, double-walled heat exchanger. As the water runs through there, if it's hot enough, the floor loop kicks on.
Okay.
And then it starts, in effect, going through the floor, but the two fluids never mix. That's the thing. I don't have glycol in my floor, and I don't have water in my panels. I have a glycol mixture.
Water's in your floor.
Yeah, oh yeah, straight water.
Water's in your floor.
Yeah, it's never going to freeze. Water's more efficient at exchanging heat than glycol. So it's cheaper.
And then there's glycol in the panels.
Yeah.
So the glycol goes through the panels.
Yeah.
Through here, and there's a heat exchanger in here.
Yeah. And then goes back into the panels in a continuous loop. These are the solar powered pumps. And the pump, the 50-watt solar panel, is a controller. Because whenever there's enough sunlight to make hot water, there's enough electricity
pumping.
To run the pump. And then this auxiliary pump is just, kind of think of it as a booster. If once the water reaches, say, 120 degrees in my loop, which is about as hot as it ever gets.
That's when that goes.
That kicks on, yeah.
Okay, just so you're not overcooking.
Well,
because those pumps aren't fast.
Yeah. Again, I wanted to keep the flow rate high and the temperature loop low. I didn't want to see 140, 150 degree water coming, glycol coming back. I like to keep it down. Usually what I end up running is a delta T of about 20 degrees.
Okay.
90 degree coolant coming in, 70 degree going into the floor, maybe 110 degree glycol coming down from the panels on a hot day or a sunny day, and then 90 going into the floor.
What does this heat exchanger consist of?
It's all stainless steel. And it's a bunch of plates all put together, and it's got all these little passageways.
I'm surprised how small it is.
Yeah. Me too.
But it's efficient.
It's very efficient, yeah. And the reason I can tell is my delta T, which I believe is the terminology for the differential. The temperature, yeah.
So that heats the water up in the floor to 90 when that's 110 out in the panels.
Yeah. No, any professional plumber looking at this is going to shoot himself in the head. But it all works, and it's worked for years, and it's all separate from my domestic water system. Right. And then I can shut all the valving down for here. The ball valves are right there.
Okay.
So if I'm doing like I was doing a big project in the hangar, all the hot water is going to the hangar. None going up here.
Yeah.
But I got big south facing windows, So this, if it's sunny, you know.
It actually, that helps.
Yeah, it'll heat this place just fine.
Man, I love it. Okay, so that's...
That's the strictly solar...
That's strictly the solar panel.
...of it. And then in addition, I've got the wood-fired boiler. Just a tube within a tube. It's all those mild steel.
Now, did you bought this from somewhere?
I built it.
You built this?
Then here's the water, the water jacket you can see here.
Okay.
And then this is the firebox. And it's offset to where it's just a little bit underneath, but more up top. And the my other one, my first one was real similar to this, but the big epiphany I had after years of running it was don't shove, even though you can, 4 foot long lengths of wood in there, because what you have is a fire in the front. And as it's progressing back, it just creates a lot of smoke. It's not efficient. It's a smoldering fire. It's not what you want. What I've done over the last 10, 12 years now, this is my average length of wood.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Small fire right up front. The air intake is right there. Okay. Outside air comes in.
Okay, I see it.
So exhaust
air. This right here is air intake.
And I actually get this kind of like the flame path kind of does this.
Okay.
So... Think of this not like a four-foot firebox. It's more like a one-foot firebox with a three-foot heat exchanger, right?
Gotcha.
So the rest of the firebox is just more surface area to exchange the heat. So once water in this shell reaches, I think it's 110 degrees is the set point on the aquastat, which is here.
Okay.
It kicks on this circulator pump and circulates the water, and it's a closed loop. It's not glycol. It's just a separate...
Okay.
Loop of water that circulates up through a 100-foot coil of 1-inch type K soft copper tubing that's immersed in a stainless steel tank underneath this outer shell that has 200 gallons of water in it.
So water and water. So
yeah, they're both water.
They're both water.
But they're separate, yeah. So in other words, the water in here in the boiler and the water in the copper loop is all the same water, and it's all sealed off from the 200 gallons in the tank and in the floor.
So the tank water and the floor water is the same?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
And then, so when I start a fire, about 45 minutes later, it takes a while to get everything up to speed. These are terrible. Like if you come into a cold shop and you want heat right now, forget it. That's not the way you work. You come in the night before, come back, and then the next 2-3 days you got heat.
Gotcha.
I mean, there's that big lag time.
Big lag time.
But like right now, it's comfortable in here with this from yesterday's fire. So once that reaches whatever I have my different aquastats set at,
okay,
another pump kicks on.
Another pump kicks
and
on.
And these are two pumps kicked on in series, or plumbed in series, to just increase the flow rate. I had two small pumps, and rather than buy one big one, I just hooked them up so that I'm getting the flow rate I need, I want. And I believe I have this set right now at 70 degrees. So once the water in that tank reaches 70 degrees, it kicks on, starts pumping it through the floor. The boiler will heat the water faster than I can pump it through the floor. Normally, I'll let the water heat up to about 120, and a normal burn cycle will be maybe 2-3 hours of actual fire.
Okay.
And then the actual time of pumping water before it gets down to the 70 degrees where it shuts off automatically will be 5 or 6 hours.
It also is pumping through the heat exchanger over there.
No, not going through the exchanger at all. It's going straight through into the manifold, into the floor. The heat exchanger is just for
that's separate.
And that's where it gets confusing, and I don't know if I understand it.
Yeah.
And it gets worse, okay?
Okay.
So that's basically this system. And like I say, on a sunny day, this doesn't have to do anything. That will do it all. But I also have these two, and these are not really open. This is for the house.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So this also heats the house.
Say if I'm not, I don't have a project in the shop, and I'm comfortable with it being maybe 50 degrees in here.
Yep.
But it's brutally cold and no sun. I'll start a fire in here. Same sequence happens. The water heats up in the 200 gallon tank, and then this aquastat kicks on. Depending on where I have it set.
Oh, there it is.
Yep.
So
it kicks on, and now it's taking that 200 gallons of water, pumping it down through underground lines that are insulated, of course, to the house.
Okay.
Into this radiant floor heating.
system.
And then its solar panels, you can get a shot of them through here.
Yeah. Okay.
Also can work at the same time to help augment the wood boiler. So, yeah, I got more valves and circulator pumps than I can shake a stick at. But then again, on the other hand, I haven't paid a dime for heating my house or my shop in the last 40 years. All my neighbors up here, you look at the big houses up here, they got like multiple 1,000-gallon propane tanks.
I was going to say, it's like heavy propane.
Yeah, I have no idea. But
do you have a propane tank?
No, I haven't. I haven't had a propane tank for years. Yeah, don't need it.
Yeah.
At my jobs, my crane jobs, on construction sites, I'm stumbling over wood every day.
So I mean, like, just
The trees I got up here, I actually get quite a bit of wood out of there.
Yeah.
Keeping my bike trail clear.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. these panels are inefficient, but they're also easy to make. Well, I didn't make them, but I mean, it's cost effective.
Yes.
There's a different type of hot water panel that's they're a sealed, like a tube that work under a vacuum. They're more efficient per square foot, but who cares if you have the room for a bigger panel? It's actually just like solar electric panels. Like the panels they put on the space shuttle were like 40 or 50% efficient, whereas these panels are maybe 15 or 20. Who cares if these are three times as cheap?
To heat the same amount of water with solar PV versus solar water.
Oh, yeah. Solar's gotten that cheap. Hmm. Now, the way I heat my crane shop in town is I've got a 2,000-watt array, and it makes enough electricity during the 9 months out of the year I don't need heat to build up my credit with Idaho Power, and then I just use my electric boiler. So in other words, I didn't mess with hot water panels. Yeah. I went strictly
electric. Which is way easier.
Yeah, simpler.
Simpler.
Yeah.
You don't need all the tubing and...
Yeah. Now, if I'd have had panels, I would have used them probably.
Yeah.
But I didn't have any more. You know, I had these nine, and I think the company went out of business, just like the wind turbine inverter, because solar got so cheap. I haven't seen a solar hot water system for years now. But those panels, they're at least 30 years old.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. But they're aluminum and copper. There's really nothing to go wrong.
Nothing to it.
We'll see how much electricity we're making.
Thank you, Tom, for showing us your Hydronic floor heating system. I know a lot of people are wanting to do this for their shop.
Yeah.
And
the great thing is I can come over here, make a mess, as you can see, cutting wood, chopping wood, doing whatever.
Yeah.
And I go over to the house and I'm getting the benefits of the hot water through my floor.
Through the floor.
With no mess or fire hazard. Yeah.
So do you have a fire in?
Yeah, I got a small
little stove. Very, very neat. All right, we'll see you guys on our next video. Thanks for watching.